Sam, could you describe Evil Dead?
Yes, it is a rock'em sock'em roller coaster ride of screaming horror.
It's like the best episode of Scooby-Doo ever made.
Evil
It really is like an episode of Scooby-Doo, but with gore and shocks.
Dead 1 is juvenile and it's executed in a very juvenile way, but it's punk, you know, it's savage.
Evil Dead is a film about five college students that go up to this small cabin in the mountains of Tennessee. And there they find an ancient book and a tape recording. And the tape recording that they find is a journal on exactly what this book is. And in fact, it's the Book of the Dead, a book of do's and don'ts dealing with the deceased. It's got burial passages of the Sumerians and ancient incantations for resurrecting the dead. And he warns on this tape that these things shouldn't be tampered with. But in his quest for knowledge, he goes ahead anyways, and he unleashes these evil forces. And in fact, they're still there as these children are one by one terrorized by it. It comes from the woods, this dark and brooding entity, and surrounds the cabin that they're in. And one by one, it possesses them, and their eyes go white, and they're jerked about like marionettes, and they're forced against one another. And it's a love story. No, it's not a love story, but it's a lot of fun. I don't want to give away the shock ending, but we tried to make it as scary and as fun as possible.
The worst crime I think that filmmakers can make is to make a boring picture. If it's boring, then it's all over. The audience, you've failed in entertaining them. You've committed a crime.
If you're a movie mad young guy in your early 20s, and you see that shooting style, it's like, well, what's the point of ever shooting any movie not like that?
I know.
All right, that seemed like, okay, a new shooting style has been developed and everything else looks old-fashioned by comparison.
Well, that like.
Every single thing just seems old-fashioned and dated unless you're doing that.
The most difficult shot for me personally in the picture was, it's a track beginning upside down. It goes over Bruce Campbell's head. And then the shot ends right side up. And for that, I had to be hanging from the ceiling by this, what do you call this, underneath your knee, on a rafter. And so I was actually hanging upside down with the camera like that. Bruce walked toward me, and I had to actually pick my body up with my legs and then come back down.
The first time I saw it, I think it was a real revelation, because the way Sam Raimi used the camera was completely new. It was completely, he took the camera and liberated it. I think that it propelled the film language many decades into the future. I remember a great conversation I had with Jim Cameron, and Jim Cameron said that is one of the most important film language camera pitch movies in the last 15, 20 years. And it's true because they literally, Sam Raimi pushes the medium and the narrative pitch more than anyone.
Yeah, how old were you when you directed the film?
I was, Rob, how old was I?
20.
I was 20 when I directed the film.
And the people that worked on the production were all also in their early 20s, right?
They are all in their 40s. No, they're about, on the average, about 26 years old. So it was a very young group of guys getting together and really pitching in everything they could to make the thing.
The film was not tremendously technically proficient because they had no money. I mean, it was really shot on such a low budget. But what I admired and love about the film is they didn't care that they had no budget. They still went for it.
The crazy way they shot it with all the camera doing all this stuff that we had never seen before.
Tim mounted the camera on this board, what we call a shaky cam. And we had different versions of it. One was about this big. And with it, the cameraman can run very fast, and the camera's in the middle. And it absorbs a great deal of the shocks as opposed to holding the camera like this, where it's a little more difficult to keep smooth. Also, we had a longer version of this thing. This is for the shots of this creature that is rushing through the woods. It lies sleeping until these college students disturb it. And to get the effect of it roaming the woods, we use this thing, the shaky cam. The other version of it was about a board 15 feet long. We had two men, one on each side, camera in the middle. It was the axis point. So they could move as much as they wanted, but this point in the middle would move very little. And with these different devices, we were able to move the camera around in strange and hopefully new-looking ways.
You're just watching and thinking, you know, not only have I not seen that in a big Hollywood studio film, you know, that shot, but, like, this is, like, you know, a 20-year-old doing this.
Well, the camera work's entirely Sam's. I mean, every single shot is something he had in mind.
Sam Raimi is not an easy filmmaker. He's finally in a place doing Spider-Man movies where they can finally afford to make a Sam Raimi movie. We could never afford to make a Sam Raimi movie because Sam Raimi was making a Steven Spielberg movie even when he was making his first movie.
And he talks about making this movie for $350,000 and the fact that he was 21 years old when he did it. And I remember being 13 at the time thinking, oh my God, I'm going to be 21 soon. That's right out of college. Like, this is possible.
I made a film when I was 20, like straight out of art college, a really low budget film. And the main thing in my head was I was kind of thinking, I've got to do my own Evil Dead.
To see a film like Evil Dead where everything, like weird POVs and everything was just, it was so demented and had so much style to it that you couldn't help but be affected by the movie in some fashion.
And to think, of course, that people love this movie and so many people love this movie and how it's affected filmmakers, and that definitely makes you feel proud that you're part of something like that.
And I also am able now to look at the film and see how creative it is and see, you know, what a genius Sam was and is, and what he did with so little money.
There's that Orson Welles quote about kind of filmmaking when he said about, like, you know, making movies is like the ultimate kind of train set. And, you know, watching Evil Dead, it seems to me that not only is it literally like watching a teenager with his train set, but Sam Raimi is the kind of person who would turn the kind of the speed of the train up to like sort of its maximum and make it go round until it crashed.
And when you watch Evil Dead, you feel like this is someone whose love for horror is so pure and has such vision. The movie's like exploding and bursting with talent that there kind of hasn't been, probably since Blair Witch, a film that came along, or Scream, one of these seminal horror movies that came out and kind of rewrote the rules that everyone starts to copy.
I think Evil Dead had the same qualities that other endearing horror films have. Texas Chainsaw Massacre, Night of the Living Dead, Halloween. Is that they're all low budget, they're all raw, relentless. And the directors were so resourceful with what they had at their disposal and were still able to make something that 20, 25 years later has the same impact that it had when it was first made.
And that was kind of a testament for kids coming from not Hollywood, but outside the Hollywood circle, that that you kind of can chase your dreams, and if you're unrelenting in following them, sometimes it works out.
And here I am today.
Thanks for watching. I decided to try something different for the 40th anniversary of Sam Raimi's The Evil Dead. I hope you enjoyed it. I'm Peter from Clearing the Lens. Please remember to like and subscribe, and I'll see you in the next video.